Is everybody here?
Ron's in his office.
Will he be coming out?
Thinking. It's been dark.
Okay. Oh, Bob. And Bob didn't, who's on the phone?
Matthews.
Okay. So I'd like to bring the Parks and Open Space Committee meeting to order this January 24th, 4 p.m. Do we have any courtesy of the floor? Were there any speakers signed up? Oh, they don't have to sign in now? So, well, then you could just come up. Well, it's not that formal, I guess.
It's my understanding that the bag, plastic
name.
Chris Bartolson, Bartelson, and I'm in Bethlehem. 520 East Laurel Street, Bethlehem. And it was our understanding that the bag ban,
the single-use plastic bag resolution, it's going to be up for vote at the council meeting. Yes, but if you would like to speak on it now, you're more than welcome to do so.
Yes, I did a little bit of searching today, and I was astounded at the number of municipalities, counties, states in the United States that have passed this.
Mm-hmm.
And many have done a ban and also a tax, and the tax can go to providing reusable bags to lower-income people and the elderly.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a marvelous idea that, and I know that County Council is forward-thinking, because they did pass the Independent Citizens Redistricting Commission.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Ken Kraft reported this to me, and I was like, I didn't even realize that it was in front of you, so I know that the council forward-thinking, and I hope that this measure does get support of the council. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. I just want to add that the resolution that we're putting forward today doesn't levy a tax. That's part of what the municipalities have to determine for themselves.
Right.
So we're leaving the power and the judgment of that kind of taxation in the judgment of the municipalities, who only have the power to enact this as an ordinance. So we're doing a resolution, hopefully. Thank you, Chris. Anyone else? For courtesy of the floor? All right, then we'll get on to the discussion regarding the Northern Tier Trail Plan. Good afternoon.
I would just appreciate it if you could do an overview of the report. I think we have some young people here in the audience might be interested in knowing more about it.
For the public participation, we did three different public meetings throughout the year, each in different representative areas of the county. And we also had a steering committee put
May I ask a question?
Sure.
Wasn't there an association with National Geographic at some point?
So we still are associated with that.
And can you just explain that a little bit?
Sure. It's part of the Scenic Wild Delaware River Geotourism Program, mm-hmm. which is 125 internationally marketed through National Geographic, and it's based on geotourism. So really the outdoor recreation component, small town communities, and bringing tourism to that area. So the area in Northampton County that's really defined by that is the Route 33 corridor and east. So the Northern Tiers portion in the Slate Belt and out to Portland will be consistent to everything that they're doing in that whole program itself.
So what does that do for ecotourism in that region?
The trail itself?
Yeah. So it's and being associated with National Geographic in that area.
So through the whole Scenic Wild Delaware River program, we can update events, small market events in small downtowns, wineries or such, conservation projects, and then that gets put into different itineraries. So any type of user can use that program to build trips to come to this area and look at our fine natural resources, our trails, and any type of kayaking, bike, or any other type of recreational asset that they can do. It also helps the small business community where they can put out websites on that page where someone's searching to go for a camping site or they want to go to a B&B or find somewhere to eat. They can find all this, build their own trip into it, and this trail component kind of fits into everything that's going in there.
That's exciting.
So we have the action plan, which looks at different concepts, an on-road and off-road concept. And we broke it out to several segments from west to east, moving from Walnutport and the connection to the DNL through Lehigh Township, Moore, Bushville, the Slate Belt downtowns, and then out to Portland and connecting to the Liberty Water Gap Trail. So I was also going to do these somewhat slowly or quickly, but this is the western end of Walnutport, the Liat River, the crossing at into Slatington, where the DNL trail exists now. There's three different options to really look at, on-road or off-road there, one north, south, and then one right through downtown. Going out to destinations such as like Becky's Driving or some of the other community parks that we're going to park grant program, we've been able to help do those as well.
May I ask a question on that one? And this would probably dovetail with the Portland end as well. If somebody, you know, puts a bike on their roof rack and wants to drive here and ride, is there ample parking at the ends of each portions of the trail, Walnutport and Portland, for somebody to be able to do that?
I would say the Walnutport section has a good capacity. The Portland, not so much right now. Walnutport, through the DNL, has really been working as a trail town initiative on both sides of the river, with Slatington and Walnutport as one kind of one town initiative. So on Slatington's side, they have a large trailhead, restrooms, and so forth. Walnutport has the Walnutport Canal Association. There's also adequate parking for events there and a new boat launch. So they kind of work symbiotically on each side of the river to help with trail and like both with water and night trails for boat parking and the downtowns there. So yeah, Walnutport definitely has more. Portland's looking to enhance theirs. They put a restroom in their downtown within the past year or so, I believe. And they really are trying to market themselves as more of a destination to do those types of things. But, so as I mentioned, these different segments have on-road, off-road. We wanted to look at a different view of the trail system instead of just your normal 10 to 12 foot multi path that we have in place in our normal sections. We kind of took the outline of the September 11th National Memorial Trail, which uses a bike route, a hiking route, a vehicular or even a motorcycle route, which gets different people in different areas at different times. So this segment runs from the Danielsville area out through Lehigh Township into Moore, very rural, great views of the Kittatinny Ridge there. Woodstone is within about a little distance of the main bike route there. But once roads to get this trail off the ground here. And really running at the base, but one of the key components of this section is looking at a connection up to Appalachian Park, which is owned by Moore Township. They're doing a master site development plan right now, and it's really looking at another connection to the AT, but also offering some ADA access in a very remote area.
That's
so
exciting.
There's different components that we really want to hit at as these things go east to west. Segment four gets a little bit more into some of our historic downtowns just south of Jacob, or just north of Jacobsburg. Bushkill Township's been, over the years, conserving land, both for conservation purposes around the Bushkill Stream, but also to connect a trail or pathway throughout their greenway system. And the PPL Bushkill Trail extends from 512 south into Jacobsburg right now, and they have a large majority of land heading north up to some property that has been owned by the Game Commission. That could be another section for a transitional trailhead that could get AT users as a little bit safer route than where they are now, going under 33 and going down Main Street. So bring them down on the south side of the mountain to 8th Street and have a direct connection right into Wind Gap. So once again, trying to figure out different users, different types of people, but keep mobility very safe for everyone. So this is probably one of our most urban segments, which would look at really connecting Wind Gap all the way through to Bangor. There's some promise of getting some acquisition or easement in these areas to really make a great connection in between the boroughs themselves. So connecting Wheeler Park to downtown Bangor, to the east, or Wheeler Park to the west, out to Wind Gap Community Park. So right in the smack dab middle of all of that is also the Plainfield Trail, which, as you know, with the Gulf Farm Master Site Development Plan we're doing, we're also looking at components to enhance the Plainfield Township Trail in that area. So this could be a good connection for an east-west, north-south connection right here. This section really runs from Bangor, Rosetto, out to our Mincy Lake complex, our Mincy Lake Conservation Corridor, Bear Swamp. There's an old rail line that we could possibly look at for acquisition. But this is another great area for preserving what we have as our Mincy Lake Greenway, and also enhancing our preservation efforts along those areas.
Brian, may I ask, who owns the rail line? That was my next question, because
that's
Norfolk Southern it's been challenging to try to acquire property for right away from them. So I think there's promise there then.
So actually this section had a couple different routes coming out of Bangor, looking at East Bangor Dam as a fishing, PADCNR fishing, or a fishing boat, sorry, fishing area, and then also Mincy Lake and all the improvements that are proposed to go into that. And then the last section really is running from Mincy out to Portland. Once again, there's an old rail line. There's a lot of the property that's been acquired through conservation easements or fee simple acquisition in this area. Upper Mount Bethel also has a large tract of land that they're looking at converting into more of an environmental education center for the rural area. This trail has the capacity to go on the outskirts of that and really connect downtown Portland to that, and then really into as well. When we looked at the whole east-west connection, the main connection going north to south is the Plainfield Township Trail. And through some of the community meetings that we saw, there was an area of Chapman that we really thought historically should be looked at and enhanced. So during that planning study, there was a small spur that ran off of one of those down into Chapman, and then eventually could connect down into Bath, where the North Bath Trail will extend into. conservation efforts along that so we can build our greenway and also build the recreational component of the trail itself.
Great.
And I'm sure the funding aspect is going to be coming up. So we do have what looks like a very large fund sum of money to build this trail. But through over the years, there's a host of different funding opportunities in here, anywhere from transportation dollars to conservation dollars, county funds, municipal funds, federal funds. There's a whole host of wherever these segments fit together, we can really identify different funding sources to do those projects. There's about 6 pages of different funding sources. That's really the overview. I hope that was enough for everyone to review the past year.
Are there any questions?
First of all, I want to commend you for the work you've done on this. I think it's a terrific opportunity. I do notice in here you did include the hotel tax for tourism, and I've been banging that drum for a long time. You know, rather than some of these speculative projects that come before us, this is something that's real. You know, rather than go and see bugs inside of a dome, people could actually go out on a trail and view nature in its existing form. I guess
in its natural habitat. Yeah.
One of the things that we've done for trails in this county before is signage. And I think that one of the things we could do as a starter is to look into signage. Is that something that you've considered have come up with a budget for?
The first steps, besides putting some of these into the long-range transportation plan through the Lehigh Valley Transit Study, that signage and the branding is one of the first steps that we would really do. So I think later this year we'll use some of the signage branding efforts to get some of these out, because I know there's some municipalities that are, if they put the signs on the streets or the areas that they own right now, they're ready for it.
Okay. And of course, another big challenge, I was kind of snickering here when you said about the length of time, is acquisition of right of way. How many miles or meters of right of way do we need to make this thing happen? And you know, I know the last one we were at was a couple of years ago. They said it was 30 years for us to, my hope is that it doesn't take that long. But what do you see as the obstacles for right of way acquisition, and what can we do to work with either the property owners or the municipalities to make that happen?
I think one of the unique things that we did with this plan and what was done in normal past trail plans, instead of looking to acquire old rail beds or property just for that trail corridor, we kind of left it open. So it could be somewhere we use municipal or PennDOT right of way to finish sections off, and it might be a little bit of a grass strip. On a low volume or a grass strip with a 10-foot path next to it, it's very doable compared to being in a downtown. In a downtown, there could be transportation or tourism or other types of economic enhancement dollars to redo streetscapes. So I think as we pick and choose, and whoever the municipalities that are really coming forth to be willing to work with us in the very beginning, those are going to be kind of like the low-hanging fruit things. And then I'm sure some of those things are going to come where we may have to wait a little bit to acquire some land, or as we've seen in other plans, readjust the route as time goes, because we may know that there's a landowner that is just not willing to do anything. Mm-hmm. And so we have to adjust that route a little bit. It is a feasibility study, so it's not set in stone that the trail corridor is as how it is in this plan. It's meant to be a little bit fluid. So I think over time, we will see some changes to the corridor route, but there are municipalities and others that they want to get this going as well.
Mm-hmm. And so, what municipalities have the initial buy-in now, who are, let's go?
I would say from Bushkill East is very, very, very willing to go with the whole slate.
Mm-hmm.
connections. Upper Mount Bethel is literally one of those ones that if we can get them some road signs to put them on some country roads to connect from Portland to Mincy, they're willing and ready to do that as well.
Are there any municipalities or that you know of that are adverse to this?
Not adverse, but maybe not ready to take the step right now. So they may have some
hesitant
priorities that just another trail doesn't really seem to be in their wheelhouse within the size there.
Okay. So you're probably going to be starting in that east of Bushkill.
Yeah. I think Bushkill East is probably one of our hotbeds for this section right now. It's the components of it. Moore and Lehigh, very rural. We're going to have to really look at some back roads. There's a property that's been bought up between Bushkill and Bangor that could lead to a trail network almost within the next couple of years here, built on ground. So, once again, it's willingness for the municipalities, the landowners, and also our strategic funding, how we can pull all of that together to get this stuff done.
Okay. Great. Any other questions? Ron? Mr. Heckman? President Heckman?
Anyway, you were touching on this, and I know you're going up Bushkill East. Sort of the northern tier is my old wheelhouse, and I spent a lot of my life up there, a lot of family. Going west, I take it you're not feeling a lot of buy-in. They're wondering what's the point, because I may get into heavier Pennsylvania Dutch territory, and there it's usually like, fine. My question would be this. When you go up and you talk to them about the benefits of tourism, and there's actually some cash maybe that can come their way, because if you talk about the beauty or the environment, sometimes they'll point to their field, Zach, look at the birds out here. But and you may get that feeling from some of the supervisors up there too. But I guess what I'm wondering is there buy-in from, have you aggressively or assertively talked to anybody up in that northern tier going west yet, or haven't you really gotten into that with them yet?
Through the plan, we've reached out to every single municipality along the route. We've done, through our consultants, we've done surveys and spoken with supervisors or board members, each individual municipality. I wouldn't say that west of Bushkill is not accepting this route. It's more of a land ownership component and roadway component. It's just that east of Bushkill has a corridor that they've been purchasing land to make that south connection. Wind Gap into Pine Argyl with the Plainfield Township Trail, smack dab in the middle of that. There's a lot of land that is already accessible to make that connection. So it's a couple miles here and there. It's just the Moore to Lehigh is a little bit vaster expanse. I've been in Lehigh Township, has the Lehigh Township Rail, authority. There's a small group of that are very interested in this. We've had various conversations with them coming outside of Wallingford and having where to go. And that's how a lot of these routes were figured out, is talking with them. So I think it's the land ownership, the road, and just the larger scale of in between downtowns from Bushkill West.
Okay. Yeah, I know times are changing, and more people, I should say, that they don't, but more to get different people involved and more open-minded maybe. But are the groups, in the past, I remember going to certain functions, and that the Planning Commission would be involved in things like these. There was groups, even Rails to Trails, even if it's not necessarily part of one of their projects, and various organizations. Is everybody sort of on the same page? Are you being able to coordinate with those different groups?
Yes, very much so. And it's been surprising, especially for me, to see this come in as a great opportunity just to even think about a 35-mile trail on the north end. for Patty. I would have really ever thought.
Okay, great.
It's a great area. It's really very scenic. It's a beautiful area of the county. And frankly, I mean, I've said this before, and the executive would know. I think if you went up to 10 people and mentioned Bear Swamp, they'd look at you with a blank expression on their face. But I mean, it's almost like north of 22, south of 22. We have two counties that we run. But the thing is, it's a beautiful area. I wish you a lot of luck. That's all. Thank you.
I'm trying to get an idea what your trails look like on the roads. I'd imagine your back roads you're using. Are you looking to use the road, or you adding a piece alongside of the road? Or
once again, varying components of it. So if you kind of get up on like Mountain View Road, that's just a stone gravel, low volume road. You might get a couple of cars an hour passing. You can put that as part of the trail.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's say there's a component looking at like 987 or coming out. There's ways that we can build within right-of-way, so we don't have to look for acquisition of individual landowners, multiple ones over a long stretch. We could put a small barrier or even a grass strip and have that visual barrier between any trail user and the car. There's various PennDOT and federal rules and regulations how to build all this mm-hmm. stuff. So once again, it depends on where that section of on-road or slightly off-road is. And once again, this feasibility study, you see a blue line go across. We're going to have to dig into each and every one of these different segments.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to have to be engineered, permitted. All the safety issues are going to have to look at. So this is really like the 50,000 view looking down about how we can do something.
Very good. So this is going to be, this is already on the agenda for tonight at council, so we don't have to do anything.
We could make a motion to recommend approval by full council, and I'll make that motion.
Would anybody like to second that? Very good. Thank you, Mr. Cusick. Thank you, Mr. Lott. And on to council it will go, right?
Jim Wilson, I'm not sure if everyone knows him. He's our recreation specialist with our Parks and Rec division. I've asked him to come and talk about some of the accomplishments that have been done over the 2018. As you know, I really started in October with the division. Jim's been really, 5 years now? 6 years?
Going 4 weeks. With Parks and Rec.
Parks and Rec. And he's really been the one behind the scenes really putting a lot of the programs together.
Summarize our annual recreation and conservation plan from 2018. You should all have received a copy electronically. It looks like this, not that.
Mm-hmm.
I believe Linda emailed that to everyone. So first of all, I want to thank this council, this administration, and Executive McCord for your very strong support of parks, recreation, open space, and conservation trails. So as you may or may not know, we have 18 parks and conservation areas, 17 that we own outright, and one that we lease from the Commonwealth. Minsky Lake, we've leased that since 1975. Mm-hmm. That was our very first park that was up and running even before we built Lees Moore Park. So these parks and recreation areas encompass nearly 2,000 acres of green space across 15 municipalities throughout the county. So these 18 properties can be categorized in five categories. We have one rail trail, the 5+ mile long Norbath Rail Trail that extends from right now anyway, Jacksonville Park in East Allen Township, west to Canal Park in the borough of Northampton. We have one little 3-acre roadside rest area, Frost Hollow Overlook, which overlooks the Delaware River on Route 611 Forks Township. We have two agricultural areas. We have 235 acres at Graysdale, open space areas on the north side of Penn Allen Road, on the north end of the campus up there. About half of which is in rotational crop land. The other half is mature second growth timber. And we have a 33-acre tract, the Diefenberger tract, in East Allen Township. All but 1 acre of that is also in rotational crop land. The other acre is one of our two community gardens. I'll talk a little more about that. And then we have five conservation areas, Archibald Johnston, Gertrude Fox, Mount Jack, Monroe, and the Mesa Lake Wilderness area. They total about 670 acres. Most of those are not developed at all. They're open to the public, but they've been preserved for their conservation value. And then we have nine parks, actually developed parklands, for passive and in some cases active recreation, meaning there are parking lots, trails, playgrounds, flush toilets at some of them, picnic areas, picnic pavilions, and so they're typical county or municipal kinds of passive parkland. So the five conservation areas, their primary value, as the slide says, is really in their economic return on environmental services. So there's an intrinsic value to having natural areas, but there's also an economic value. The offset cost for things like flood mitigation, non-point source pollution runoff, carbon sequestration, water filtration is all taken care of by Mother Nature through the green infrastructure in these places, the vegetation, the soils, the streamside forests, the geology. Mm-hmm. That's not to say that they're not accessible. People use them all the time. Typically, a lot of folks who are off trail walking or birding, getting away and not seeing other people. We have a lot of educational groups that use the Archibald Johnston Conservation Area from the Bethlehem School Districts. That's the lower left-hand corner. These are all slides from our, not all five of our conservation areas, but many of them. And again, in the lower right-hand corner, 2014, we have value economic return on the environment, is an assessment that gives an economic value to the natural system services of places like our conservation areas. So of our nine parks that are actually developed, four that are most developed, offer picnic pavilions, open space picnic areas, and in the case of Louise Moore, tennis courts that are available for rent by groups of 10 or more for which they purchase a user permit. And they do that through our online reservation system. So those parks, you can see Louise Moore, 120 acres, straddles Lower Nazareth and Bethlehem Townships, first established in 1978. Bear Swamp Archery Complex, so Bear Swamp Park and Archery Complex, 251 acres in Upper Mount Bethel Township, established in 1979. Wayne Root Park is our most recent developed park, established in 2011, 200 acres, mostly in Allen Township with a small sliver out in East Allen Township. And then Wyattuck Park, which is 23 acres in Williams Township, right along 611 and the Delaware Canal and Delaware Canal State Park, and that's 23 acres. So you can stop me anytime you have questions. So just a real quick abstract of recreational rental facilities from 2018. As always, Louise Moore Park, that's our flagship park. Mm-hmm. It always gets the most reservations. You can see in total we have 484 reservations for almost 29,000 people in 2018. The majority of those guests are family and friends groups, family reunions, family picnics, birthday parties, graduation parties, followed by scout groups, school groups, corporate organizations, and church groups. The stats are right there. A little over $22,000 in revenue. We have very modest rental fees, which hopefully we can address another time this year. We had a very slight decrease this year in reservations and income by like $345. So I think it was a 1.5% decrease in income in 2018. But interestingly enough, Wyattuck Park saw a 41% increase in reservations and income. So that really supports our capital investment in planning to rehabilitate that park and bring it up to ADA standards and improve some of the recreational amenities and natural resources down there. Bear Swamp Park, well, I should say, Louise Moore Park has four pavilions for rent, and they can seat anywhere between 50 and 200 people, depending on the pavilion. Wayne Grew has three pavilions that can accommodate between 30 and 100 people, depending on the pavilion. Wyattuck has one pavilion that can accommodate 45 people.
Mm.
And Bear Swamp has one pavilion, can accommodate up to about 20 people. All four parks also have open space picnic areas, so 10 or more people up to 20 can reserve an open space area where we have, there's no pavilion, you're under the sky, but there are picnic tables and grills at those sites. Bear Swamp is reserved pretty much exclusively for scout groups and organized education groups, and waive the fee, so they're not really generating. Okay, in addition to the user permits, we also have a special use permit program for folks who are pre-approved for a specific activity. Examples of those would be stream cleanups, organized stream cleanups, scout projects, especially Eagle Scout projects, biological research, extended educational programs. So these are representative photos of all 10 special use permits that were issued in 2018. We had an organized stream cleanup at Archibald Johnston in the upper left. Next slide is an Eagle Scout nominee and his team building an accessible pathway from the parking lot to the overlook at Fry's Run Park. They also installed two beautiful park benches that were installed in concrete footers, or later tomorrow they'll be probably down in Delaware Bay. The next slide is a photograph of the Fry's Run Watershed Association hosted a native plant sale and stream walk at Fry's Run Park. The most interesting special use permit this year, in the far right, had a gentleman call asking if he could install one beehive, one apiary set up at Grayscale. So that's over in the open space land at Grayscale. I have a Lehigh team, students and professors at Lehigh University doing chickadee research up in the Mincy Lake wilderness area. They're studying the dynamics between two species of chickadees, the black-capped chickadee, which has always been here, and in more recent years, the Carolina chickadee, which was a southern species, has been expanding its range from northward as the weather warms, and so they are hybridizing and overlapping, and they're studying that dynamic. We have a gentleman, a professional videographer. We issued him a special use permit to do a drone videography of Mincy Lake and Mincy Lake Wilderness Area, specifically for the Friends of Mincy Lake organization. I'll talk about that in a little bit. They've developed some videos. He has donated his services and his time. I have a professional birder and photographer who requested a special use permit to photograph birds, warblers in the spring, Archibald Paul Johnson Conservation Area. Any birders on us? Anybody know? That colorful bird? No. It's a bit.
It's not a
finch.
It's not a finch. It's not a finch, is
no,
it?
No, it's a warbler. It's
a warbler, black warbler.
We have these incredible tiny little warblers.
A yellow-bellied sapsucker.
A warbler. In the summer months to breed and raise their young and gorge on caterpillars. And then they spend the winter months in the Caribbean and Latin America, they bring these wonderful tropical colors to us. And then I have a Lafayette team, teacher and students doing turtle research on ponds at Bear Swamp and at Twin Lakes in the Mincy Lake Wilderness Area, taking blood samples from different species and taking the blood samples back to the lab and analyzing the blood oxygen level of the species. We have a Lehigh Valley Model Airplane Club that forever has received a special use permit. They have a model airplane field right across the street from Grayscale on the open space lands. And then the bottom corner photo, I have another Eagle Scout doing an Eagle Scout project at Louise Moore, where he and his team are replacing all the lost, broken, weathered tree identification plaques for the many trees at Louise Moore. that Louise Moore Park is this incredible arboretum. Over 150 species and varieties of trees and animals, 47 years old, planted back in the 70s. Examples from North America, Europe, and Asia. And some of the finest examples of certain species anywhere in the region, according to some professional botanists who have visited. So I'm going to strive to get that acknowledged, Louise Moore Park, if it's certified as an arboretum. Okay, so in addition to those 29,000 people that visit our parks, we also had 5,600 people participate in outdoor recreation and environmental education programs this year. And we divide those into three categories. Programs that the division, namely myself, organizes and presents or facilitates. We had seven of those. Things like our annual Kite Day in Park, Louise Moore Park, I believe we're coming up on our 28th or 9th year for that. Birding programs, stargazing programs. This is our third year. 2018 was our second year on a contract with the Wildlands Conservancy to provide outdoor recreation, environmental education programs, as well as environmental restoration projects. So they provided 33 programs for 434 participants in county parks last year. Things like day camps.
Mm-hmm.
They had a weekly preschool program. National S'mores Day. There actually is a National S'mores Day.
Why don't we get invited to that one?
Yeah, right. This year, we're going to do some exciting things. We're going to do some creek snorkeling in Monocacy Meadow and Monocacy Creek, and perhaps at Portland Waterfront Park on the Delaware as well. And then the third-party programs are programs that occur in county parks but are organized and presented by third parties.
Mm-hmm.
And lots of those, as you can see, almost 5,000 people. Examples of those would be the annual Northampton County Sheriff's Easter Egg Hunt.
Oh, yeah.
With
all those eggs, huh?
Northampton County Conservation District's Youth Environmental Program, High School Environmental Program. Things like 5K walks and runs. Penn State Extension has Master Watershed Steward and Master Gardener programs there. U.S. Tennis Association loves our tennis courts at Louise Moore Park. They claim they're the best public courts anywhere in the valley. They have professional championships and playoffs there every year. So those are examples of the kinds of third-party programs. We also have a community garden program. I mentioned earlier at the Diefenbacher Track, we have 26 plots. We have 56 plots at Louise Moore Park that was established in 1982. So probably
who knew?
27, pushing 40 years of community gardens there. They're big plots, too.
Mm-hmm.
405 square feet, so they're like 15 by 24, something like that, whatever 405 square feet. And they're free of charge. You have waiting lists for them. There's people at Louise Moore have been gardening there for almost 20 years. What's really cool about that the last couple of years, we, the county, and our gardeners participated in the Planter Row Lehigh Valley program. It's a national program, Planter Row. Lehigh Valley chapter organized about 4 years ago. And the way that works is community gardeners donate excess vegetables, produce to local food banks. Our community garden at Louise Moore Park, all the donated vegetables there go to Mass Fair Food Bank. And the ones that you can do for track are at the Second Harvest Food Bank.
Mm-hmm.
And as you can see, over the last 3 years, and I give it a weekly update from the Planter Row coordinator, the number is about a dozen community gardens, and our gardeners are always second, third, maybe fourth in the poundage of produce donated every year. And over the last 3 years, they've donated, almost over 2,300 pounds of fresh produce, which have provided vegetables for over 5,000 meals for local food and school families. So that's a pretty big deal.
That's exciting.
Okay, 2018 Parks, Recreation, and Conservation Projects. You have Parks and Recreation on one hand, Conservation on the other, two sides of the same coin. So again, I thank this council, administration, and executive board for their support of these kinds of projects. I want to look at these are mostly capital projects that were funded either through county dollars and or grants. So we'll take a quick look at each one. And livable landscapes, that is the current Parks and Recreation Plan. It's an open space plan, and it also addresses parks. And that's a an award-winning plan that Brian was spearheaded. 2015, it won a state award as an outdoor recreation open space plan by the Pennsylvania Association of Land Trusts. The first plan for the county was developed in 1971 with the Green Valley Planning Commission. That was updated in 1980. It was next updated in 2002 as County Parks 2010, with the plan. And then most recently, 2015, that plan was then developed as livable landscapes. And all the projects that we've done are either recommendations in this plan or supported by this plan. Gulf Farm Park Master Site Plan Development Project. This year we, or last year I should say, contracted with a firm to help us develop a plan for the 160-acre Gulf Farm in Plainfield Township to develop that into a regional park and a trailhead for the adjacent Plainfield Recreation Trail. We'll continue planning this year, and I think that planning should wrap up in 2019.
For the plan, yes.
Right. And then phases implemented, you know, in the years after that. The Mincy Lake Greenway project, so we have, and it's been a recommendation for years, is to link. We own 800 acres of land in the Mincy Lake Greenway. Bear Swamp Park, Mincy Lake, we lease, but there's 311 acres of public land. And then we own another, I think, 650 acres. The Tots Gap properties, you may know them as, most of them are contiguous, upslope north of the lake. So we want to link those all together by a trail network and also connect them to all the other thousands of acres of public lands up there. Delaware Water Gap National Recreation Area, Appalachian Trail National Scenic Corridor, Cherry Valley National Wildlife Refuge, the trail systems that Brian spoke about earlier in Portland, the 9/11 Trail, the Liberty Water Gap Trail. So we secured last year from DCNR $75,000 that the county will match this year to begin the development of that plan. Mincy Lake, we have park rehabilitation plan. As you may, I'm sure you know, Mincy Lake has been drained for a rehabilitative dam rehab project. The state owns the lake. The dam is now 15 years old. It's time to be rehabilitated. So the lake has been completely drawn down, which provides basically a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to get into the lake base and improve fish habitat in there. I'll talk about that in a bit. But also to begin to think about rehabilitating that lake and bringing it up to snuff for access for everyone. So, two years ago, the county paid for a report, a survey essentially, of upgrades to Mincy Lake infrastructure upgrades, recreational amenities, facility upgrades, lighting, stormwater, all of that. So we've got about a $3.5 million long-range plan that will be implemented over many years and many administrations, I would assume, going into the future. We did receive a $200,000 grant last year from DCNR to begin that process. The county will match it, so we've got $400,000 to begin phase one, which will be the installation and construction of accessible kayak launch, an accessible fishing pier, accessible restroom facilities, some bridges, lighting. We're working with Board Safe, and the gentleman in the photo is on our Friends of Mincy Lake committee. He's the spokesmodel for that organization. He is in a wheelchair and he's a championship kayaker, and he's lending his professional advice and technical assistance in to that end. Mincy Lake, a lot of Mincy Lake stuff. So we've got a trail, got a nearly a 2 mile long trail that wraps around the north side of the lake, crosses nearly 25 streams and wetlands, and it's in pretty rough shape, so we really would like to improve that for hikers, walkers, to be able to more cleanly and comfortably cross those wet areas. So we contracted with a firm last year, Gilmore & Associates, to begin the plan, design, engineering, and permitting for improvements around the lake. Our long-range plan is to, there's never been a bridge that spans the spillway, the bottom right-hand corner. Our plan is to install a bridge and actually make, for the first time ever, an actual hike that would be a nearly 3 mile walk around the entire lake.
Oh, wow.
The Norbath Trail East End Extension Project. In 2017, again due to Brian's efforts, we finally extended the western end of the Norbath Trail from the west end of Northampton Borough all the way to Canal Park. now connects it to the link, which is, you know, hundreds of miles of trail networks in Lehigh and Northampton County. The final stage is to connect the last 1.5 miles from its current eastern terminus at Jacksonville Park in East Allen Township all the way to Mill Street in the borough of Bath. We've started work, engineering design work for a trailhead there. So hopefully we'll move forward again with that this year. Park signage and kiosk project. We contracted with the Gecko Group, which is a design firm down in Port Philadelphia who has done extensive signage work for state parks, municipal parks, other county parks, to develop using destination signage, kiosk standards, and branding for the county parks division. And we're just about at the point where I think we know what we want as far as the standard goes. And the first piece of implementing that is to design and construct, fabricate this year, entrance signs for 10 parks and the North Avenue Trail. Those 10 parks are Portland Waterfront, Mincee, Bear Swamp, Gold Farm, Frost Hollow, Bry's Run, Wyattuck, Louise Moore, Wayne Grove, and Monocacy Meadow, and the North Avenue Trail. So some of those, like for example, Monocacy Meadow, relatively small 8-acre park, there'll be one entrance sign there. But some like Mincee will have two entrance signs. And the Norback Trail will have multiple signs at the various trailheads. So we're pretty excited about that project. The Wyattuck Park Rehab Project. So Wyattuck Park, 23-acre park in Williams Township, established in 1982. I believe Gordy, over his years with the division, did upgrade some of the facilities there a couple times, namely the playground, but it's in sore need of modern rehabilitation too, particularly the pavilion. So we contracted a firm, we've begun that process late last year, and we'll continue that into 2019, hopefully do some implementation work in 2020. Okay, now on to some of the conservation projects that we've done this year. Our American Chestnut Tree Restoration Project. We actually partnered with the American Chestnut Foundation and the State University of New York's College of Environmental Sciences and Forestry to hopefully rebirth the American chestnut. Mm-hmm. That partnership has developed a blight-resistant chestnut tree. Mm-hmm. The chestnut tree was essentially wiped out 100 years ago by an accidentally imported fungus from Asia. Called the chestnut blight. You know, scientists call it the worst ecological disaster in forests in history. Completely decimated. And the photograph, obviously a historical photo, that's what chestnut trees look like here in PA and throughout the Appalachian region, all the way down in Kentucky and Alabama. Okay. Completely wiped out. Well, I shouldn't say completely wiped out. What happens is once they mature to a point where they begin to lose pollen and nuts, that's when the fungus attacks them and kills them. You might get a small crop of nuts. You can find suckers of these growing on stumps, even on the Blue Mountain. Mm-hmm. The partnership has developed this mother tree program where we established two plots at Louise Moore Park where we planted 16 8-inch plot native chestnut seedlings. So mm-hmm. they will die in like 7-8 years.
Mm-hmm.
But before that time comes, we will plant, hopefully sooner rather than later, a blight-resistant tree that we will receive from SUNY and the American Chestnut Foundation. Mm-hmm. They're working on federal permits for that right now with FDA, USDA, mm-hmm. and others. They have the tree, they just need the approvals, and then we will be given one tree, one mature, young mature, blight-resistant tree that will be planted, one each in those two plots, and they will pollinate the native trees,
mm-hmm.
which will produce nuts, half of which will be blight resistant. And that's the game plan to restore the chestnut tree. It's the fastest growing, most widespread, abundant, economical hardwood forest in all of the East Coast in the turn of the 20th century.
Didn't Northampton County receive a gift of American chestnut trees last year? And what happened to those?
That's,
was that part of this program? Okay.
Yep.
That's what I thought.
Yep, that's this project. It was seedlings donated by the American Chestnut Foundation.
Okay. I thought there were more than 8, though.
There were 16, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
I think we originally thought we were going to do 24.
Okay.
But then when my
Okay.
A lot of love goes into maintaining and nurturing even one tree, as you can see with some of the hardware. The Catastrophe Creek Riparian Buffer Project, we partnered with the Wildlands Conservancy to receive a DCNR grant for forest buffers a couple of years ago, and we've improved, we planted 300 container stock trees along nearly 2,000 linear feet of Catastrophe Creek at Wingroom. Those trees, you know, help stabilize the stream bank, mitigate against flood velocity and damage, and help provide wildlife habitat. So there's our guys with that auger 300 planting wells with that two-man auger. Did a similar project at Fry's Run back in 2015 when I was with the Conservation District. We did a pretty extensive stream bank stabilization project on Fry's Run. And as phase two of that in 2015, we planted 200 container stock trees. So now in 2018, they were 3-4 years old. They grew like wildfire right there in this floodplain soils. Mm-hmm. And a big flood came through in August, and you can see flattened them. Within a couple of days, while the soils were still wet and gooey, am I running out of time?
No. You got like a couple minutes.
Okay.
Might want to.
The soil was wet and gooey. We were able to get arbor tie and stakes, and our staff and Fry's Run Watershed Association and volunteers with the Master Watershed School Program tied and staked upright about 150 of those trees. And fortunately, they survived. What we did was a single tree, testament to the stability of riparian trees, even in that velocity of flood water they were put over, and even the root balls were uprooted. Mm. 45 degrees, we were able to put them back upright, just tying them. And early November of this year, another big flood hit down there. But they were tied upright, and you'll leave them like that for a while. I'm sure the same thing is being repeated today. Okay, Louise Moore Park tree replacement project. In 2017, mm-hmm. we purchased 45 ball and burlap evergreens to replace 45 trees that were lost in Superstorm Sandy back in the
80s. Oh, wow.
Those were big, mature trees that had been planted back in the 70s. Obviously, we're not planting that kind of stock, but we did get ball and burlap stock. We had 15 Colorado blue spruce, 15 Serbian spruce, and 15 Norway spruce. By the end of the 2017 growing season, all the Colorado blue spruce succumbed to what's called needlecast fungus. You can see mm-hmm. an image there on the right. So the fungus kills the needles, the trees can no longer photosynthesize, they can't produce food, and they die. So our vendor, Northern Nurseries, replaced those 45 blue spruce with 45 Serbian spruce, and we replaced those in May of 2018. Louise Moore Park Wildflower Meadow Project.
Oh, yeah.
We prepared a half-acre chunk of turf grass on the west side of the park that we're going to plant as a wildflower meadow. We're partnered with professional Prairie Nursery, an organization in Wisconsin. Following their model, we prepared the site for their recommendations. The plan was to do a dormant seeding this past fall. It was crazy wet, as you know, all summer. And then we have an early frost, and we were able to plant this fall, so we'll be planting that in the spring of this year. You see before and after photos on the right. The photo of the meadow in the bottom left is the ballast track in Bushco Township. They have a big meadow there, so we're going to try to replicate that and even nicer at Louise Moore. And then Main Sea Lake Habitat Improvement Project. The lake is drawn down. We've established, Fish and Boat came to us in 2017, I believe, came to the county, said, hey, this is how these dam rehab projects work. We pay for the dam, create a friends group, create fish habitat in the lake basin. We'll provide all the equipment, manpower, operators. You guys got to buy all the material, and we'll even construct the project. So we've established Friends of Mincy Lake, which is a standing committee under the North Hampton County Junior Conservation School, which has 501c3 status. So that organization has raised pretty much all the funds. I think they have, in fact, raised all the money we need, which is about $108,000 to buy hundreds of tons of stone and rough hemlock timber to build huge structures in the lake basin with heavy equipment this summer. And one phase of it was building 10 turtle platforms. So you can see a bunch of kids, they all built the 10 platforms were built this summer by Delaware River Shad Fishing and Youth Association. The kids built the platforms. The platforms are now living in the barn at Graysdale. Once the lake is filled in a couple of years, then the platforms will be placed in the lake by fishing boats, specialized boats, they'll be anchored, and will provide basking habitat for the three or four or five species of aquatic turtles that call the lake home. There's a Lindsay Lake, you can see the number of partners in that.
Mm-hmm.
Monoxy Creek Restoration Project, Archibald Johnson Conservation Area, got a 50-acre parcel park, and mostly Bethlehem Township, some of this in Bethlehem City. It is strewn with all sorts of wonderful, cool, old-timey stone features, walls, dams, weirs that are falling apart and really are negatively impact the function of the stream. The creek has to struggle to get up to the floodplains, it's kind of scours. So we've worked with the Wildlands Conservancy to develop a plan to remove many of those structures so the creek can access its floodplain a lot easier with less damage in the future. And the Monoxy Meadow Parking Lot Reconstruction Project. Monoxy Meadow Park, it's been around, I'm not sure when we acquired that, I think maybe in the early 90s. The parking lot there is a dirt gravel road parking lot that's very compacted, so water just ponds and lays on there until it evaporates. A lot of times it will run off into Monoxy Creek, which is a high quality cold water stream. It's just, you can kind of see the car, I think, on 191 in the background. The creek gets at the bottom of that. So we got a grant from the Conservation District, a $17,000 dirt gravel road maintenance grant, to do a kind of a very cool, unique project there where we excavated the parking lot, 4,700 square feet. We excavated 8 inches deep, took all that material stockpiled at Graysdale, filled 6 inches worth of gravel, 2B gravel in the lot, and then put down 4,700 square feet of these pavers, these heavy-duty plastic grids, and then fill those with a smaller stone, 1B stone. So now water infiltrates and, you know, percolates down through the grid and infiltrates into the soil underneath. And it does. It works like a charm. Today, I mean, it's crazy flooded there today. I'm going to be down tomorrow, and I was there after, we did this in December. We've had some rain since then, and the water completely
Mm-hmm. Very good. I want to be mindful of our next meeting time starting. So you have about 2 to 5 more minutes, okay?
Okay. I think I'm just about 2 seconds. So wildlife habitat, we've partnered with the Pennsylvania Game Commission. We enrolled all our acreage up in the East Lake Corridor in their public access program this year, which allows us to then participate with them in a wildlife habitat project, which is funded through USDA.
Mm-hmm.
The Game Commission develops all the plans. They develop plans for 5 sites, 4 up in Minsky Greenway, 1 at Graysdale, and we'll start implementing those plans this year. Most of them focus on restoring some of the meadows, the cool season agricultural meadows, into warm season grass meadows for mostly for grassland and birds, which are among the most threatened group of critters in Pennsylvania. Changing farm practices, etc. These are our partners that we work with throughout the year, 17 partners, including different departments within the county, Indian Administration, Conservation District, DCED, and all these other nonprofit and state agencies. So I think I've got just one more. So all things, I guess they say what's So this is what it looked like back in 1974 under the old commissioner-style government. The first park board, the first and only park board, was established in March of 1974. With this cast of 7 wonderful characters. These folks were part of that board for 10 years. I can rattle off names real quick from left to right.
That's not Peg.
Van Busker. All these folks have passed over here in open space in the sky. But Bill Van Busker, he was a railroader with the Winnipeg New England Railroad, and Dr. Paul Fretschner is the next guy. He was a professor of government and law at Lafayette. Margaret Hay, a retired school teacher from Forest Township. Richard Kent, I love that guy. He's like a real, you know, Thurston Howell third there. He was a railroad subsidiary. He was the president of the railroad subsidiaries of Bethlehem Steel Corporation. Mm-hmm. And Louise Moore, our matron saint at Louise Moore Park. August Buza, who was the CEO of Lehigh Valley Chemical Company, and he was the vice president of the Northampton County Prison Board and vice president of Northampton County Industrial Development Corporation. And Paul Lentz, who was the president CEO of the Coffee Cement Manufacturing Company. So these were accomplished professional people. All of them also had deep connections to conservation. Some of them presidents of the Nazi Watershed Association, big scout leaders, municipal park folks. Fast forward 45 years later, March of 75, and this is what we look like today. Motley crew there. We have 18 salaried staff with Parks and Rec. We have another 13 seasonal hourly folks in the summer months. And this was at Gordy's retirement party, so our top dogs from Public Works are in there too, Scott and Mike. In the background, two of the guys in the far right are two of our park attendants. Mm-hmm. So that's us.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. Yes, and thank you for all your years on the Conservation District and,
sure.
and parks. I know that Louise Moore Park has to be one of my favorite parks in the Lehigh Valley. I've actually rented that park twice, or the pavilion twice, for my son's birthdays, and I know that the fees are very low. So I understand why you want to talk about that in the future. But I think that the parks program is really important, just to have these as resources to go to for a preservation, conservation standpoint and a recreational standpoint. So I really appreciate all that you do. Thank you. Anybody else?
Again,
Mr. Lowe.
Thank you for taking care of the gems of the county. Is there any consideration? I heard you say there's a waiting list on the community gardens. I wouldn't imagine that's much of an expense to. Is there room, and could we add on to that so more people could use that?
When Gordy was still there, we talked about creating another community garden at Wayne Grove Park. We could certainly expand the one we have at Diefenderfer. We broached that. It hasn't gone much further than that, but it's certainly, I mean, community garden is a big thing. It always has been, but especially in the last few years, since Mr. Billy ratcheted up the organization support on that. But, so it's something we can certainly address a little more seriously.
Thank you.
Yes or no answer? Is all this on the website, for example, fees and whatnot, so
yes.
Public?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes.
And Jim's report that has all this information is up on the
Everything's
website.
Up there, so you can get it.
Thank Excellent.
You.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you, Brian. Is there any other business that anybody would like to bring forward? No? Then we can adjourn the meeting.
We need to take a 5-minute break to reset for the next meeting.
Sure we do. Thank you.
Maybe three, but how's that?
Three, five, whatever. Awesome.